TV, radio, and the print media, Kimberly is the Senior Foreign Policy Advisor for the Committee for Responsible Foreign Policy. Did you hear that, Joe? By the way, she's covered the news with an outside-the-beltway perspective. Her experience as an investigative journalist ranges from national security issues like Gitmo's Khalid Sheikh Mohammed 9/11 trial, immigration, and foreign policy issues. TV's correspondent for CW6 News in San Diego, as well as One America News Network. Her website is The KD Report, and she should be streaming live on Facebook.
Hey, Kelly, how are you? How are you doing, Chuck?
I'm doing okay, and I decided, hey, I'm going to use the long intro I have on you because it talks about the 9/11 trial and all that. And yeah.
Well, I'm actually wearing...
We got through that, didn't we?
I actually added to my cross I normally wear. It's a peace sign that my daughter brought back from Ground Zero less than a year after the attack. So I always like to wear that around my heart right around 9/11 because, you know, we must always remember, we must never forget.
Absolutely. Well, I've got the wrong T-shirt on today because it says Navy. That's all it says. It doesn't really say anything. It's just printed. But anyway, because, you know, I'm a Navy guy.
Okay, yeah.
So there you go. Your latest report is basically saying, hey, Afghanistan's got a brand new credit card, right?
Oh,
with
yeah.
The Taliban's $83 billion left over for them.
Yeah.
Of course, what are they going to do? Go out and buy all those wives a special present?
Well, maybe they'll do that. But one thing they are doing is over the weekend on 9/11 in Iraq, one of our U.S. and allies air bases there was hit by two drone strikes. They did not kill anybody on the ground, but this just goes to show you that, you know, word that we got out this morning on it, that this was most likely an Iran-backed militia in Iraq, letting the U.S. know that whenever they feel like they can come over and strike. Now, once terrorists have hold of these kind of weapons, which now we know the Taliban does have these weapons, they're going to be able to learn how to use these weapons more accurately, and it's going to be a lot harder to stop the next strike. And, you know, they can simply use smaller drones in what they call a swarming attack, where, you know, we saw what happened with the airline that landed in the Hudson, and it was a bird strike, basically, that took that plane down, and it was successfully landed in the Hudson River there. But what we're seeing now is because we left all of this arsenal behind, they are now going to have the roadmap, and they're going to have the directions on how to operate some of this stuff, and that's going to create a tremendous favor on their side.
Yeah, I also heard, I thought I saw it maybe flash by one time on TV, but that they were really celebrating over there too on 9/11.
Oh, yeah. They were.
Like celebration. Yeah.
Yeah. This is going to continue to happen. And it's just, I mean, you know, 9/11, we always talk about, you know, how many people died when those towers came down and the Pentagon was struck, and in Shanksville, which I've been to all three memorials. But we have to remember the 44,000, you know, Americans, troops that died, and the thousands upon thousands of others who've been injured, whether it's with PTS, TBI, or losing limbs that we will have to be taking care of the rest of our life. So it's also a time to remember them and the sacrifices that they made in protecting this country and protecting it fairly well.
You know, Kimberly, during the summer riots, and even into now, when they were screaming, you know, defund the police, defund the police. And you remember during the riots when the fire department would pull up and try to put something out, and they got bombarded with particles and all this other stuff. Sunday evening, last night, when the time of this program, 60 Minutes did a whole hour on 9/11 fire department. And you think you know just about everything, but those guys just said, yeah, we're going to die, but we're going to see how many we can get out before we die. I mean, that was almost like the bottom line.
Well, yeah, even the guy that the Navy SEAL that took out bin Laden, He wrote letters to his two daughters apologizing for not being there when they graduate high school or getting married, because he really felt the mission that he was going out on to go get Osama bin Laden was a one-way ticket. And he stated that on a Fox News special that they ran last night. And it was also a quite compelling piece, and it really focused on the Osama bin Laden raid. But I mean, this is why we're all, out there doing whatever we can to prevent against a terrorist attack on the U.S. soil right now. And you've got Navy SEALs, you've got military leaders, you've got a bunch of different analysts and academics all saying that it's now the threat level has been raised to such a degree that there's a very high probability we're going to start seeing some attacks on the homeland. Now, something that kind of, was kind of also put out there last night from the Middle East. Now, we thought that the leader of Al-Qaeda, Al-Zawahiri, was killed, but he came out with an hour-long video, propaganda, of course, video, and then wrote a like 850-page manifesto. And he's encouraging anyone who's in America or around the globe to please go out and do these lone wolf attacks, because it's very, that's what we're susceptible against, because those are smaller attacks. Those are harder for people to figure out what they're doing, because they're not really affiliated per se to any group or another, and we don't know when or where they're going to do this, which requires the Americans to actually, when you're out at the shopping malls or grocery store, to be much more vigilant. And now we're gonna have to go back to, when we saw backpacks sitting somewhere. Are we calling the bomb
Oh,
squad to make sure it's not that? So I mean, we're headed back to those days.
I read a thing today where, and I'm going, boy, they come up with some crazy stories, but it had to do with the newly arrivals who are terrorists, but they didn't know, okay? Because there's got to be a sprinkling of bad guys that came over here, and but they said they have all these different ways, and one of the ways. And I read this and I said, well, I'm not going to read it on the news, but I'll mention it to Kimberly, is that they give you a mask. Hey, here's your free mask. These are really working against COVID. And about 4 hours later, you're dead. And people say, oh, that ain't going to happen. But see, also, I'm going to go way out on a limb here, Kimberly, okay? They have a guy in America that we have to be very careful about what he says. He was vice president and informed everybody that the one who wiped out Osama bin Laden was SEAL Team 6. And then you saw what happened to them, right?
That was supposed to
So,
be kind
I
of a
mean,
secret. So anyways, but
yeah,
now
this
he's
is our leader,
president.
but he couldn't hold it in, right?
Well, I
It's
mean,
just,
and I
oh
think,
boy.
as all of this, as we get further away from America's hasty exit out of Afghanistan, and we're starting to kind of, look inward and see what we did wrong, and specific agencies within the Defense Department are going to be looking over the mistakes that they made here. And you have the President of the United States, who actually authorized this over and above, advice apparently from high-ranking cabinet members. But he went ahead and did it anyways, because he knew this was the right decision. And this just, added to his long list of wrong decisions that he's made on foreign policy.
If
And
you're going to do it, if you're going to do it, take your time and do it right. Go
it's,
ahead, sorry.
yeah, exactly. Well, I mean, and we really should have never left Bagram. That should have just been our base. We have troops sitting in Germany, we have them, in South Korea. We needed something in that region. And we've conceded this, in essence, to the Taliban. And someone who I don't typically agree with is Leon Panetta, and he was a former CIA director as well as SecDef under the Obama administration. But he's come out with some very, very sane words and telling, informing Democrats that you guys better get a hold of this, because I'm telling you, the Afghanistan that under Taliban rule is already back, and they're inviting terrorist groups like ISIS and Al-Qaeda, and they're going to be encouraging this hate. They've already started killing boys who are, you know, sons of their fathers who they wanted killed and out of the way. They're killing boys, so when they grow up, they don't, you know, come and want, you know, to inflict some sort of retaliation against the Taliban. So, I mean, I'm not certain how that sounds like, you know, the Taliban has changed, but apparently Joe Biden feels that the Taliban has changed. They haven't. And what we're seeing, the pictures we're seeing, and some of the imagery that I'm getting a hold of, I mean, it's atrocious. And then, again, to find that, you know, the hasty retaliation drone strike that Biden, you know, ordered and they all bragged about, well, it turned out they killed one of our own USAID workers who was loading bottles of water to get them to people who needed water, and they wiped out these people. You know, I mean, this is not a government that is operating with the interest of the United States and their allies.
Well, didn't Clinton bomb the aspirin factory?
Yeah.
That ring a bell?
Yeah.
Is it only, I know that, you know, conservative presidents, they're not always, you know, right all the time. But they have a pretty good record of not being able to catch up with a lot of things that the other presidents have done that were not Republicans.
Well, I mean, obviously, if in the fog of war on all of these issues, things are going to go wrong. We're not going to get everything correct. But there was a right way to get out of Afghanistan and a wrong way. And Biden took the wrong way and then some. And this rests on his shoulders. I mean, you're seeing a country. My daughter was telling me over the weekend that she went out to dinner with some friends, and there was a table that was sitting out there with 13 chairs and boots under it in remembrance of the 13 service members that were killed there. So, I mean, you're talking about even liberal California, you're seeing things like that. This is not a thing that's going to go away. And as fast as, you know, they want to turn to spending $3.5 trillion on God knows who only knows what's in there. And, of course, with Nancy, we got to pass it before we can find out what's in it. But, you know, and I mean, even young people, they're looking at this and saying, you know, what we did was wrong. That was wrong. These people did not have to die. These, you know, its blood is directly on Biden's hands. And, you know, he's doubling and tripling down on these areas of his way is the right way. And all it's going to do is lead to more Fort Hood attacks. It's going to lead to more, you know, Samir Khan, who was planning attacks over in Yemen. It's going to lead to more Times Square bombings, the Boston bombings, all of these attacks on the homeland. That's what all of this is going to lean towards now. And the lone terrorist attacks are the hardest to fight against. And that's what this country is staring down.
You know, Kimberly, and I apologize because I was talking about somewhere I saw this story about masks. It just happens to be in your latest report. I forgot to turn the page because I read it most of it last night. And, you know, and who am I? I got it written down here somewhere. Oh, yeah, Pittsburgh. I see it.
Yeah.
Anyway, the other thing is in this gigantic bill, you know, and you're absolutely right about you got to read it so you can find out what's in it. There is so much goodies, so many goodies in there. We're Congress members, you know, like you really need more money, don't you?
Yeah.
Well, it's ridiculous.
Not even that, but what I find ironic is we've been giving Afghanistan billions of dollars every year from the U.S. taxpayer, not only just with the weapons and whatnot, but, you know, with, you know, money to pay for the soldiers, the Afghan security forces. And, you know, U.S. aid people that are on the ground trying to help the U.S. and the Taliban people. That money's out there. But now, after our hasty, retreat out of Afghanistan, which is a huge embarrassment, you know, that the terrorist world obviously is still cheering about. But, you know, when you look at that, now the Biden administration is asking for more money to help them again, because now they need medical aid and now they need supplies. And I mean, it's like I think the unmitigated gall is like, really? Now you're going to send more money to a corrupt, Taliban government? I mean, I just don't think anyone in America that is of their right mind will look at it and say, yeah, we ought to be helping them out. Yeah, but it's just,
Maybe
it's
he got a ransom note, you know.
maybe, there you go. And he'll pay them off apparently now, so very
I'm
sad.
going to tell you, and I think you'll agree, that the largest percentage of all these people that we brought out, the Afghanistans that are now going to be placed in America,
Yeah.
they're not going to change their belief.
Nope.
All right? And whenever you believe in Sharia law, wow, and
Yeah.
especially if you're a female and you're saying, oh, come on, they're going to be okay. And they're taking over a lot of spots throughout the globe. Isn't that right, Kimberly?
Yes, they are. And, I mean, and we have to remember too that in the Afghan constitution that the U.S. helped author, this, the country would be run under Sharia law and its tenets. So, they are going back to women have to wear burqas. They are going to go back to the days where women can't leave their homes without males, a male presence.
And honor killings are gonna be through the roof
Oh,
because,
yep. You protest and
oh yeah.
that's your
Hey,
life.
there's our break. There's our break. Kimberly Dvorak streaming live on Facebook, and you can read see and read all this at the KD Report a little bit later on. She is the senior foreign policy advisor for the Committee for Responsible Foreign Policy. And a website again, the KDReport.com.
You order a glass of your favorite Cabernet, fresh asparagus, hollandaise on the side, a filet, medium rare. You unfill your napkin with a flair, close your eyes, and prepare to listen. Ah, there he is. The sweet music you long to hear. The sizzle. The sizzle of a Ruth's Chris steak.
The most magnificent corn-fed prime beef. Broiled to perfection at 1800 degrees. Some call it a sizzle. We call it an anthem.
As the waiter approaches, you think, is this one mine or that one?
Ruth's Chris Steakhouse. Like Ruth always said, life's too short to eat anywhere else.
Make a reservation online at rootschris.com or by calling 800-544-0808.
Let's talk about your credit cards. When you first start using them, it's a slow drip. You make charges, then more charges, then bills come, and they keep coming. When you open your statements, the floodgates come pouring in. You realize you have more credit card debt than you can afford, and you're barely making the minimum payments. Wouldn't it be nice to make one affordable payment and have all your credit card bills covered? Make this free call and learn our responsible way to get your credit card bills paid and under control.
Sponsored by Consumer Education Services, a nonprofit organization.
800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. That's 800-876-3643.
CESI is not a loan company. The establishment of a debt management plan may adversely affect your credit rating. Non-payment of debt may lead creditors to increase finance and other charges to undertake collection activity, including liquidation.
It's been tough talking to my doctor about constipation with belly pain, discomfort, and bloating. I finally laid all my symptoms out there and how they keep coming back. She said I may have irritable bowel syndrome with constipation, or IBS-C. We agreed it's time to try something different.
Linzess, or linaclotide, is a prescription medicine that treats IBS-C in adults. Linzess works differently than laxatives. It lets you have more frequent and complete bowel movements and helps relieve overall abdominal symptoms, belly pain, discomfort, and bloating. These symptoms were studied in combination, not individually. Do not give Linzess to children less than 6, and it should not be given to children 6 to less than 18. It may harm them. Do not take Linzess if you have a bowel blockage. Get immediate help if you develop unusual or severe stomach pain, especially with bloody or black stools. The most common side effect is diarrhea, sometimes severe. If it's severe, stop taking Linzess and call your doctor right away. Other side effects include gas, stomach area pain, and swelling. There could be more to your story with IBS-C. Visit a doctor in person or online. Say yes to Linzess. Learn more at linzess.com or call 1-800-LINZESS. Sponsored by Abbvie and Ironwood Pharmaceuticals.
Everybody's talking at me. CRN with Kimberly Dvorak, senior foreign policy advisor for the committee. Committee for, get this, Responsible Foreign Policy. Call her George, Joe. I said, sorry to say George. Would that be George Bush? Okay, here we go.
Okay.
Anyway.
All right. So I have a few points.
They're not going to change, are they?
No. I have a few points I'm going to make.
Ahead.
Okay, so when we were listening to what Al Zawahiri was talking about, the headline for the interviewer that he released was Jerusalem will not be Judaized, meaning that they're probably going to go after the U.S. Embassy in Jerusalem. And, you know, inside the 852-page manifesto, he goes after Donald Trump. He didn't particularly like Donald Trump as president, but it's worth noting that they waited to come back and regain power in Afghanistan under Joe Biden because they knew he was weak and that he wouldn't do anything, which is exactly what happened. And also over the weekend, we learned that Haqqani was named to the cabinet of the Taliban. The FBI currently has a $5 million reward on his head. So I guess at least we'll know where to find him. And I always like to finish with, who is the big winner out of this? Who wins? And I say the winner out of all this is not necessarily the terrorists. I mean, we can take care of them in a couple weeks if we unleash our full potential and let our commanders on the ground actually do their job. But the winner of this is the Chinese, because now they are going to be able to go in and get the coveted, rare earth minerals. They're going to continue to see America, its debt continue to climb out of control, when and how we're going to pay back for this. They're going after, cyber attacks and, with the intent of trying to get some sort of EMP strike, which would, eliminate all the, power grids in this country, and very dire circumstances would happen. Americans couldn't take medicine, food would go bad, things of that nature. So I think we need to look at those kind of in lessons learned, and then guess that they're gonna go after all of this by using those weapons that the U.S. left behind, and also the billions of dollars a year of the weapons that the United States defense industry continues to sell to the Middle East. So it's a powder keg. I wouldn't be surprised to see if Iran jumps into the ring and starts deciding they're going to start fighting with some of these other countries. It could be a hugely disastrous regional war, because we've got India, who's our ally. You've got Turkey, who's a NATO wants to be a member of NATO, but they're so left. They're Sunnis. And they're going back to Sharia laws and taking away all the rights of their citizens. So you're just seeing a cauldron there in the Middle East. And it just takes one fuse to be lit, and this whole thing's going to spark World War III. And that's something that Leon Panetta said in his interview over the weekend, that this could be considered a World War III situation, and that this was a burgeoning disaster for what's going on. And especially with the military still worried about everybody has to have diversity training, and we need more women. The things they continue to focus on.
That and global warming. The woke and global warming, that's our top priorities. Oh,
there we
boy.
Go.
We
and the power within. The enemy within, too. Yep. I mean, that's what General Milley said. And I turned off.
And
I couldn't watch.
Every border.
Yeah.
You know what, Kimberly? Every single airport, major airport right now, is an open border for Afghanistan, and then also the open border down south.
Yep.
Congratulations. Hey, thank you very much. Look forward to our next visit.
All right.
Kimberly Dvorak, thekdreport.com. It'll be posted there a little bit later on. Coming up next,